heard for years. I've learned to keep it inside. Well, now it's coming in loud and clear. I want a deeper life. It's about love, it's about laughter, it's about comfort and smiles. It's about love, it's about kindness, it's about hearts open wide. It's about love, it's about passion, it's about taking a chance. It's about love, it's about service, it's about lending a hand. About lending a hand. Swing wide the doors, the time is right. Swing wide the doors to let in the light. Bring in the dawn for humankind. Swing wide the doors of this heart of mine. Swing wide the doors of this heart of mine. Swing wide the doors of this heart of mine.
I pray for others. I pray, trusting Spirit, to know what is best for those for whom I pray. I pray for others, affirming their highest good. I release the ideal that I know the right answer or outcome and confidently place all in God's care. Peace enfolds me when I place my faith in the Christ essence and power within others to heal, comfort, prosper, and guide them. As I pray for others, I also pray for my own understanding and faith to be quickened so that I may be calm and reassuring presence. If I become tempted by fear or worry, I remind myself that my energy is best used for positive, faith-filled thoughts, words, and feelings. I release and redirect my attention as I need it, knowing I am keeping the high watch for those I hold in prayer. I thank my God every time I remember you, constantly praying with joy in every one of my prayers for all of you. Philippians 1, 3, and 4. My name is Chaplain Chris, and I'm available to pray with you and for you for any of your life's concerns on this glorious journey, right? And I'm honored to serve you all. Thank you.
So let's get comfortable in our chairs. Let's take a couple of really deep breaths. Father, Mother, God, we are grateful for all the abundance in our lives. We are thankful for all of the loving and caring and support we are experiencing with each other. We are grateful for the time that we had with our wonderful Juanita, for all of the life lessons she taught us, for the personal growth we all experienced in her presence. May we always feel her joy for life. We know this also is part of the journey we are on. I know we aren't able to pick and choose the parts of the journey we want, but we really don't like this part much. May we all be guided to continue to walk this path with love in our hearts. May we continue to care for and support each other. May we stay open to all possibilities. And to remember our mantra on this search, Trust in the Lord with all your heart and do not rely on your own insight. In all thy ways acknowledge him, and he will make straight your path. Proverbs 3, 5 and 6. Amen.
Let's get still. Let's go into that place where we find comfort, where we allow that still small voice of God to be heard. For God so wants to be heard by us. And we get to choose to quiet the mind and to allow that voice within us come forth. For it is said that there is no place that God is not, and therefore God is in the very breath that we take. So we breathe. We consciously choose to breathe in more of God. So as we breathe, we turn within, putting aside all the busyness of the day, all the activities of gatherings. We just put it aside and we allow ourselves to just be in this moment of now. Be okay in this moment with our connection to the still small voice. Be still and listen. Ask yourself, what is it that I need to hear from God? What guidance? What piece of understanding am I seeking? What action do I need to take? For prayer is the asking, and meditation is the listening for the answer. Many times we get the answer from God, but we say, it must be for someone else. That's not what I meant, God. So we resist the answered prayer. And is it because we fear it is too much for us to do? Too big a task? If we feel that way, then now's the time to ask for strength and courage to do what is mine to do. Am I afraid to walk with God? Because somehow I talk myself out of the good that awaits me. If that's the case, then we ask God to open the door to our hearts and to trust and to walk in our faith that God never gives us anything we can't handle. We all have the tools we need to do God's will. For we go within and we see ourselves as you truly are, successful, radiant, and endowed with the potential to achieve all that God guides us with. My awareness of my faith in God is ever expanding, for I choose to keep the door to my heart and my mind open as I let the guidance of God infill me. For I love to know and serve God more and more each day. Today I choose to plant only positive thoughts about God and myself. So rather than idly sitting by waiting for God to speak to me, I take the necessary action to be in service to God through serving others. I have the necessary faith to fulfill all that God asks of me. I have the necessary faith to fulfill all that God asks of me. Repeat that silently to yourself. I have the necessary faith to fulfill all that God asks of me. For I walk with courage, I walk with strength, doing what is placed in front of me to do with an ever-expanding faith of God. For God does not abandon me, but rather God holds my hand and walks with me. So today I choose to breathe in the guidance and wisdom of God, and I choose to take that guidance and walk with God. As I acknowledge within that I choose to be a servant of God. I choose to be part of His ever-expanding clarity in my life. And there is no job of God that is too big for me to handle. For God gives me all that I need to walk and be that child of God, that light of God that moves through us. So I breathe. I feel the breath of God entering my body and permeating every part of my cells. And I acknowledge inwardly that I am grateful to experience the presence of God. I am grateful to experience the presence of God. And so it is. Amen. And so it is. Amen.
Join us.
is moving ever upward. My feet are leaving the ground. Up, up, up to a high place. Up, 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 far beyond this time and space. Up, up, up to a high place. I feel my soul rising to a higher place. Higher place, higher place. I feel my soul. My soul rising to a higher place. No more downward, no more darkness, no more wondering the point of it all. My life is destined, oh, for greatness. My soul has answered the call. Up, up, up to a higher place. Up, 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 far beyond this time and space. Up, up, up to a higher place. I feel my soul rising to a higher place. Higher place, higher place. I feel my soul rising to a higher place. Higher place, higher place. I feel my soul rising to a higher place. I feel my soul rising to a higher place. I feel my soul rising to a higher place.
With me. when I'm weary, filled with despair? Who gives me courage to go on from there? And who gives me faith that will never die? Somebody bigger than you and I. He lights the way when the road is long. He keeps you company with love to guide you. He walks beside you just like he walks with me. When I am weary, filled with despair, who gives me courage to go on from there? And who gives me faith that will never die? Somebody bigger than, somebody bigger, somebody bigger. Somebody bigger, somebody bigger than you and I.
Thank you.
And you have to follow that?
Yeah.
I thought I'd tell you just a little bit about Monica, Reverend Monica Driscoll. As if you didn't pick it up, we had some training, leadership training yesterday, and it was just fantastic, and everybody went out of there really, really excited about what's going to be, in, what is in store for us. She says her nickname is Rev Mo. I can't wrap my brain around that. Calling your minister Rev Mo, I don't know. But once you get to know her, it's a little easier. So she told me she began her quest after reading Prosperity by Charles Fillmore in 1983. She became a licensed Unity teacher in 1993 and then was ordained in 2012. She was a senior minister for Unity Church of Christ in South New Jersey. And that's where she met Rita. And so if you really want to know the scoop on Rev Mo, talk to Rita. She's a transition ministry consultant for Unity Worldwide Ministries. And she believes she has been called to help churches through transitions toward healthy spiritual relationships. Rev Mo is also serving UWM as their at-large judicatory, is that proper?
Yes.
Judicatory representative for the ethics review system. Now, if you want to know what judicatory means, talk to Bill. Where's Bill? Okay, he's lobby lurker, all right. So I can really talk about him. And I tell you, if he's still president after this week, after my meltdown this week, he's a good guy. I gave him a thing or two to talk about or to hear. So getting back to Reverend Monica.
I can defend myself.
Oh! I think we're going to have some fun around here, you know? So Reverend Monica is committed to Unity principles and strives to live her life in accordance with divine guidance. And through my conversations with her, it's really apparent, and that really is the truth. She enjoys traveling, talking politics. Oh, please, no. I'll let you learn about that. Okay, but she likes to hike and swim and go to sporting events, so she's probably going to watch the Super Bowl today. Her favorite Bible quote is, "With man this is impossible, but with God all things are possible." She is the author of States of Mind. It's a 2-CD interpretation of the Beatitudes. And it's for sale in the bookstore for a measly $10. So if you're interested in the Beatitudes, I think this would be a real good investment. And then she is nearing completion of her first of many books. It's called Climb Out. It's a humorous retake of growing up in a large family and finding God in the dysfunction. Anybody relate? And I think that we will probably start the workshop a little earlier since we're not having potluck. So we had potluck last week. We're having cake and there are some goodies out there. There's some snacks and things, but we're not having the potluck. But anyway, we'll try to start 12:15, 12:30, whenever we can, after we get our goodies. Okay, great. Well, with no further ado, I would like to introduce Reverend Monica Driscoll.
Thank you. Usually when I speak with someone on the phone, the first thing they say to me when they meet me in person, I thought you would be taller, you know? And I have no problem with that. I used to, but I don't anymore. You know, we take God very seriously, don't we? It's an important aspect of our lives, but it doesn't have to be that way. So I take God a little more lightly. So I open up my services with a joke. And my mom, who was raised a Baptist, married a devout Catholic, and part of her wedding vows was that her children would be raised Catholic. And that was a pretty prominent thing to do back then, and she never wavered from that. She didn't participate in church, but boy, she sure made sure that we got dropped off, you know? And she was faithful to that. And so when it became evident in my 30s that I was moving in the direction of ministry work, she was a little bit taken back because, you know, what does that mean? Are you going to be a nun or are you going to be a priest, you know? And I didn't aspire to either. I just wanted to be the one communicating a positive message of God. And that was my inner calling, even though the Sunday mornings were anything other than that for me as a child. And so she gave me, as part of my becoming a minister, she gave me some church jokes, and she gave me a whole booklet of them. And so I committed myself to recognizing that we don't have to take God that seriously, as long as we show up for God, right? So here's my joke for today. And I'm reading it word for word, so I'm not responsible for anything I say. Just clarifying that. A priest, a pastor, and a rabbi all served as chaplains in the armed services, and under the duress of wartime, they made a wild bet with each other. When they got back stateside, they would each find a grizzly bear and attempt to convert them to their religion. The priest and pastor were called to a veterans hospital some years later, where they found their friend, the rabbi, in terrible condition, with IVs and wires everywhere and in a body cast. He seemed asleep, so the two of them began to quietly catch up on their lives. And of course, the bet came up. The priest had found a bear, and as soon as he got close enough, he sprinkled it with holy water, tossed a communion wafer into its mouth, and read it from the catechism. The pastor, who had equal access with the bear he found, he had tricked the bear into slipping into a creek, where he quickly dunked its head under the baptism, immediately gave it a nice casserole for its first potluck, and read from it the Bible. As they were congratulating each other, the rabbi opened his eyes, as he had been listening the whole time. He said, "I suppose the circumcision may not have been the best place to start." Thank you for laughing. See, now that I have you where I want you. So let's start out by sharing a little bit of some Bible. I like to include humor, Bible, and a message metaphysically somewhere in my talk. So this portion is for the Bible part. So Jesus is in his third year of his ministry, and you read from Matthew 17:20, and I'm going to give you some of the history right before that and a little bit of history what happens after that. And so before Jesus finds and heals this young boy, his disciples are out in the valleys and in the communities healing people. And they've been instructed. This is in Jesus' third year of his ministry. So he is getting an inkling of what's about to come, you know. So he knows that he's got to espouse into these 12 wonderful people that he's chosen how it is that they need to operate, because he knows his days are numbered. Because the angry, disappointed, unchanging folks are starting to gather larger and larger around him. So he knows this. So he sends his disciples out two by two and says, now go heal. And they are doing that. But every once in a while, they run into something that they can't heal. And they're perplexed. And so the Bible verse starts out where, in right before this, Jesus is up on the mountain of transfiguration. So he is experiencing an enlightened moment for himself. What's happening is now, I don't know if you've ever been to the Mount Transformation. It's a harrowing, single-lane road with no guardrails, and it just goes up and up and up to this mountain. And it is that way today. It's a dangerous road. So what happens is there's communication. If you're coming down, no one else is on the road. If you're going up, no one else is on the road. So it's limited fare. So even the donkeys were not riding up. But there was Jesus with two of his disciples at the Mount of Transformation. Well, there were people at the bottom who were waiting to be healed. They were waiting for Jesus to come down from this experience. So there's a crowd gathering. He gets to the bottom, and there's a man, and that's where this Bible story comes to. When they came to the crowd, they're coming down from the Mount of Transfiguration. He's had an enlightened moment at the Mount of Transfiguration. A man came to him and knelt before him and said, Lord, have mercy on my son, for he is an epileptic and he suffers terribly. He often falls into the fire and often into the water. And I brought him to your disciples, but they could not cure him. Jesus answered, your faithless and your perverse generation, how much longer must I be with you? How much longer must I put up with you? How much longer must I put up with being here and the work not being done? And Jesus rebuked the demon, and it came out of him. The boy was cured instantly. When the disciples came to Jesus privately and said, why could we not cast it out? He said to them, because of your little faith. For truly I tell you, if you have faith the size of a mustard seed, you will say to this mountain, move from here to there, and it will move, and nothing will be impossible for you. Amen. Amen. You see, but he's angry. There's this part of Jesus is angry with this. He doesn't understand, my goodness, what more do I have to tell you on how to do it for you guys to be successful in this? And he's diminished in his own right, but he doesn't admonish them to that great length. Now, this story is also told in Luke, and I would encourage you to read it in Luke, because it expands even so much more on the concept that our faith, even though it is as small as a mustard seed, packs a punch that is unlimited to us. And you see, because faith is one of our 12 faculties, one of our spiritual powers, which tells us we already have all the faith we will ever need. It has already been endowed within us. So we're not asking for more faith. We're asking for understanding faith. To clarify my ability within that small seed that is so tiny. Now a mustard seed, one little mustard seed, grows into a tree that is a safe harbor for thousands of birds. It is a fabulous part of our desert story in Jerusalem, for they grow with little water, little care. You see, because our faith needs only an opening of our mind and our heart to expand into the unlimited possibilities. But we talk ourselves out of it. We say it's not possible. We say it's bigger than us. We say that there's no way that I can achieve what the guidance is telling me to do. So we discount it, we move aside, and we say, no, it is not mine to do. So what's happened for the disciples is they see this child who is so severely unwell that they talk themselves out of the possibility. and they say, it is not ours to do, it is for someone else to do. Now in the Luke version, it's very enticing, the Luke version, because Luke writes to the common man. Matthew's a little heady. But Luke writes to the common man, and Luke describes the scene as the father coming up to him and saying, my son needs you. And Jesus says, well, how big is your faith? And the man says, my faith is so faithful and so large that I see all possibilities with God. And I see you representing God. And Jesus said, so by your faith, your son is healed. And the boy gets up and walks away. Because our faith is what catapults us to the next dimension and the next clarity with our understanding of God. It is us that turns away from our ability to believe the possibilities. Because truly, with God, there is no impossibility. There is only the possible. You see, because our limited mind is based on our senses, and so our senses see the mountain could never be moved. And yet, because we can't see it, doesn't make it not so. Because we can't smell it, doesn't make it not so. So think of an orange. You've just sliced an orange and opened it up. How many of you can smell it? It just, well, there is no orange. How could you possibly smell it? And yet we do. It is through that sense nature, the human essence of us, that is spoken to our faith. And it is our senses that we need to step back with and say, you're not in charge, God is. And with God, I see beyond my human capabilities. I see the wide open arena of all that is placed in front of me to do. Because we talk ourselves out of answered prayer. You see, we even say to ourselves, you know what, I don't think God answers my prayers. How many say that? It's a common thing. I make a prayer request and by golly, he just doesn't listen to me. And we start to discount the guidance. You see, because every prayer is answered. Always. But because you haven't gotten the answer you want, therefore he hasn't answered us. And we simply say, we literally in our mind's eye, will say, you must have meant that for someone else. That's not what I was talking about. I was looking for an answer that looked like this. And we put that answer in a box, but with God there is no box. There is no lines around it. There's no dot, dot, dot. There's no 1, 2, 3. It is just is that wonderful essence of God. We think that God has given us something that is bigger than us, and yes, he has, because he sees in you the unlimited possibilities. It is us that limit God, not the other way around. So he admonishes his disciples because they gave up the faith. They gave up the understanding and clarity that they had when they healed the seeming easy ones. You know? And this was a tough one for them because they could see the demon within this child. And the demon is the darkness of our faith. We choose to close our eyes to that goodness of God. The glory light that we ask for is sitting there waiting to be fulfilled within us. And so we turn away from that rather than just the opposite and say, wow, I never thought that was possible. Bring it on, God. You know, one of my favorite affirmations is, pick me, God, pick me, God, I'm ready. And it scares the living bejeepers out of me. And we do it anyway. Because when we trust in the guidance of God, it never leads us to someplace that we can't be. No matter how the road unwinds for us to get there. It doesn't matter how it unfolds. And when we are sitting in the darkness and have received the answer that we didn't want to hear, our prayer becomes, I am willing, even if I'm kicking and screaming. I'm willing, God, guide me in that process. Sometimes we make decisions and we turn away from the guidance of God because somebody in our life objects to that. We're familiar with that, right? Yeah. And you ask yourself, maybe that's too much for me, because now my relationship, I'm not sure why I'm saying this, it is not in my talk notes, but somebody needs to hear this. Never let another person talk you out of God's good.
Amen.
It's very easy to happen. We think the relationship will suffer, the change is too big, and the truth is, that's not the truth. You be the best possible person you are with your guidance, and that person will follow you. Hand up behind me. You're running too fast for me to catch up. Let them catch up. Because you're giving them the gift of following the inner guidance of God. Because nothing is too big for you and God. Nothing. As you go through your ministerial change these next couple of months, nothing is too big for you guys. I've only met a half dozen of you, and let me tell you something. You guys got a great congregation. I mean, grounded in spiritual principles. We all need work, though, don't we? And we're working through it. And so your prayer request for your ministry is, may the leaders of this church be continued to be guided by the wisdom of God in how can I serve them. And some of you are going to be called in ways you never thought possible. I don't have the time. I don't have the resources. I don't have the energy. I have all these other things that we need to do. And then your prayer request becomes, God, give me more time than I ever thought possible. See? Because every obstacle that you run across when you are called to do something, you work through God to get through that obstacle. And you don't let your senses tell you you can't do it. Your mind plays wonderful tricks on us. It will talk us out of our good. And you know why? Because we don't think we're good enough for that good. And that's a lie. If you've been given the guidance, you're already good enough. Do you need a little bit of help to get there? Probably. And who do you turn to? God. You turn to God for that inner guidance. When you run across that stumbling block to doing what is placed in front of you to do, you seek out the wisdom of God, and you will receive it. It may be black and white, it may be in the color of the rainbows, but you will receive it. And then you go the next step. This seems a little bit too big for me, God. Increase my awareness of my faith of how powerful you are in my life, and you continue to affirm to walk through any obstacle that is placed in front of you. And that's walking with God. Doesn't mean you all become ministers. But it does mean that you seek out the inner guidance of God on a very, very regular basis. How much is too many times to ask God for help? Exactly. 100 times 100 and infinity. God is always listening. God is within you with every breath you take, and you give yourself permission to breathe in the wisdom and understanding of God with every breath you take. With every obstacle, seeming obstacle, we seek out the wisdom and guidance of God. Because nothing is impossible with God. It is only us that need to strengthen our understanding of faith. And a little bit of faith goes a long, long way. A long, long way. Never give up on what you've been guided to do. Never allow yourself to turn yourself away from God's good. Never. So I have some homework for you. Can't leave you without homework, right? That would be rude of me. Answer the question. What seems impossible to you that you've been given a guidance? Before you lay your head down tonight, ask the question. Maybe in between a commercial. What seems impossible to you? And then ask, are you sure it's impossible? Or is this your human nature denying you the unlimited possibilities with God? For God really does give us something that seems totally impossible in our lives. Remember, with God all things are possible. Be willing to be wrong about how you think you're supposed to do it. And that's the hardest thing you'll ever do. To to let go of your assured rightness and to say, you know what? I don't have a clue how you want me to do this, God. Help me out. And as you go along the way, your ego will kick in, your human senses will kick in, and you'll find a roadblock, and I'm willing to be wrong that this is not the way for me to go. And we just open our hearts to a different way. Because open and receptive to all of God's good that awaits you. Because there is not only an unlimited possibility with God in your lives, there's an unlimited possibilities of good in your life. And God is sitting there waiting to give it to you. And we keep turning it away. How many of you are asking for more money? It's okay, right? Right? How about your prayer request changes just a little? Give me all the resources I need to be the best possible me I can be. Because that might be a bigger number than you had in mind. You know? So thank you for the pennies, and thank you for the quarters, and God, keep bringing it in because I like bills too. Different prayer request. Put out there what you want. But don't limit it. Because we limit God in our thinking and in our actions. You have an unlimited possibilities, an unlimited amount of resources, an unlimited connection and relationship with God. So grab it. Grab it with that small seed of mustard. And if you don't know the size of a mustard, feel free to go into any of the grocery stores, buy a little thing for $2 or $3, put it on the counter, spill it on the floor, and you will not find them all. They will continue to rise up years later. You will find a mustard seed. But our faith, as little as it might seem to be, is enough. We just need to have more understanding faith. And one of those obstacles is limiting God. So we commit today to not limit God. And we ask, what is the big picture for me, God? Some of you are already being guided by that. Continue to seek out the wisdom. But if you feel like you're a little stuck with God, broaden that horizon. Go outside the box and be part of this wonderful collective consciousness that this room can change the world. This room. And so I wish you the best of it because there is so much good to come. And Godspeed. Amen.
Twinkle, though, dark, you'll find by the mighty glory. Listen to my story. Glory, listen to my story. Ride a mighty high, take the load off your feet. Hear what I'm saying, hear what I'm saying. It will set your mind at ease. I was just a son, a lonely soul indeed. God took all my troubles as He did, He set me free. Take the load off your mind, ride a mighty glory. Listen to my story, ride a mighty high. Off your mind, by the mighty glory, listen to my story, by the mighty high, He led me to discover the person I could be, let Him be your leader, He's so good, He'll set you free, listen to my story, listen to my plea, let Him be your leader, He will end your misery, come on and ride, the mighty high. Story, ride the mighty high, come on and ride. morning wide. The mighty high. Come on and ride. The mighty high. Come on and ride. The mighty high.
Extraordinary minister just gave us a message about Juanita Sokol, Kostin. Amen.
Amen.
Here is a woman in my life who carried a bag of mustard seeds around her. I'm telling you the truth. And she could walk faster than I could run, but I tried to catch up with her, and I did. And the day she was admitted to the hospital, I asked her for the 50th time, if she would marry me. She's on the bed and said, "Get down on your knees, mister." And I did. I'm telling you, I did. This is a woman who believed in joy and brought it here to stay. And I labored with true love, extolling her virtues every day of our togetherness. Every day. And I really appreciate your ministry, because I feel it in my heart, and I live it every day.
Thank you, sir.
With this woman who still lives in me. Tuesday is Valentine's Day. This was the first day that we had chosen to get married, this week. Unfortunately, that was not to be, but I want to honor your message and repeat to you all, live in the moment, right now. And I did, every day. 3.5 years ago, she was cancer-free, hallelujah. And we did not waste a minute feeling sorry for ourselves. We were exhausted with excitement every day here in this church, here with you people. We planned 4 family reunions, 1 here, and so on and so on. And she wrote 5 books about people like you, about people who hadn't seen each other in 30 years. Shame on them, but they came anyway. And I didn't waste any time being in the moment until she passed, when she passed in my arms. As I sang to her the song, "This joy that I have, the world didn't give it to me." No, the world didn't give it, and the world can't take it away. Oh, no sorry, buddy. And I told her many times as she was passing, I could feel her heartbeat, how much I loved her. And I will carry that for many years from now. And last year, this time, I gave her this rather large Valentine's card, which I always made by hand. I really want you to hear this, because women, you have to allow men to come up to your standards so they can raise their own. And men, you got to see the ladder and climb up to it, and be grateful when you got there.